Morning and welcome to Worship with the Salvation Army Bedlington. It's so good to have you here this morning and worshiping with us. I want to let you know that today we're going to be focusing on hope and joy. And our scripture reference will be from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. So if you want to look that up and have your Bible ready, that will be what we'll be focusing on today in our service. And we'll have a guest speaker today. Major Mark Dooley will be speaking this morning. And our focus, again, will be on hope and joy. What a God we have that can give us that hope and that joy in our lives. And we are the people that can receive that hope and that joy. So get your cuppas and let's get ready to worship together today. And I want to remind you again, on the 6th of September, we will have our first worship service in the hall. And again, it is limited seating. So you'll want to make sure that you call in and reserve your seat. And again, there will be a slide at the end of this service giving you some more details. So let's get ready now to worship together. Get your cuppa. And let's worship together. Let's worship the Lord today.
Thank you. Somebody's Praying, a song by Ricky Skaggs. It reminds me of the power of prayer. The power there is when you pray for someone. You have a hand in releasing that power in someone's life when you pray for them. And so this morning, think of someone who is struggling. I'll bet you know someone. Someone struggling financially, possibly with health, or possibly with relationships. I want you to commit to pray for that person for at least a week. Watch the power of God go to work in their lives. We should also keep in mind our core as we start up in-person meetings. We need to do it right, and we need God's guidance and help. Let's pray for this country, our Prime Minister and our MPs. There's a lot of criticism of our leadership and their handling of the pandemic. You know, it's so easy to second guess them. It's not easy to make the tough decisions, and we need to support them in prayer. And so let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for each one listening to this worship service. Lift them up in their homes, in their workplace. Could be the same place, actually. Let hope in you fill their lives with joy. Encourage each to pray for one another. We really need to lift each other up. Lord, help us through this pandemic, and we pray for a vaccine and the quick production and distribution of it. We long for life the way it was before the pandemic and hope for things to get back to some sort of normal soon. Thank you for this medium where we can continue to get together, though not in person. I pray that your Holy Spirit would anoint this, that you would speak through this, and that your word would come alive for us this morning. Thank you, God, that you are in control. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Somebody's praying for me. Angels are watching, I can feel it. Angels are watching over me. There's many miles ahead till I get home. Still I'm safely kept before your throne. 'Cause Lord, I Lord, I believe your angels are watching over me. Well, I've walked the barren wilderness, where my pillow was a stone, and I've been through the darkest caverns, where no light had ever shone. Still I went on, 'cause there was someone who was down on their knees. And Lord, I thank you for those people praying all this time for me. Somebody's praying, I can feel it. Somebody's praying for me. Mighty hands are guiding me to protect me from what I can't see. Lord, Lord, I believe somebody's praying for me. Somebody's praying for me.
Peter, Jesus Christ's missionary. To the Jewish Christians driven out of Jerusalem and scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Ossia, and Bithynia. Dear friends, God the Father chose you long ago and knew he would become his children. And the Holy Spirit has been at work in your hearts, cleansing you with the blood of Jesus Christ and making you to please him. May God bless you richly and grant you increasing freedom from all anxiety and fear. All honour to God, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for it is his boundless mercy that has given us the privilege of being born again, so that we are now members of God's own family. Now we live in the hope of eternal life because Christ rose again from the dead, and God has reserved for his children the priceless gift of eternal life. It is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. And God, in his mighty power, will make sure that you get there safely to receive it because you are trusting him. It will be yours in that coming last day for all to see. So, be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though the going is rough for a while down here. These trials are only to test your faith, to see whether or not it is strong and pure. It is being tested as fire tests gold and purifies it. And your faith is far more precious to God than mere gold. So, if your faith remains strong after being tried in the test tube of fiery trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honour on the day of his return. You love him, even though you have never seen him. Though not seeing him, you trust him. And even now, you are happy with the inexpressible joy that comes from heaven itself. And your further reward for trusting him will be the salvation of your souls.
Thank you. Good morning. I consider it a privilege to be invited to speak to you all this morning, and I pray you will be blessed by what God has laid on my heart. I've chosen as my theme today, hope. And during the past few months, we've seen so many people who seem to be without hope, always worrying, always thinking the worst. It doesn't really help, does it, when the media bombards us with negative stories day after day after day. The Bible tells us that there will be difficult times, but in the midst of it, to never lose hope. Our scripture reading today focused on true hope. Is there any hope really for a person who constantly puts his foot in his mouth? For a person who blows hot and cold? For a person who can say things that bring high praise one moment and a severe rebuke the next? Well, welcome to the Apostle Peter. Peter, the one who denied the Lord but preached the sermon that kick-started the church. Peter, the one who so often spoke first and thought later. Peter found hope in Jesus. Today we're going to look at that hope from Peter's perspective and discover that hope can transform us, can assure of us an inheritance, can keep us going in the midst of trials, and that the hope that we need is only found in Jesus. Hope itself is a necessary commodity for life. We can live for a few days without food and water, but when hope is gone, we've nothing left to live for. People so often look in the wrong places for hope, and just because a lot of people get their hopes dashed on the rocks of circumstance, that doesn't mean there's no hope available. To every person who looks in the right direction, they can find hope. Verse 3 of our text says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, according to his abundant mercy, has begotten us again unto a living hope through the resurrection of Christ from the dead." A living hope, a life-giving hope, a hope that is sure and steadfast, rooted and grounded in a living relationship with a living God. The first truth about hope that Peter reveals is a hope that transforms our life. This hope comes from God himself. The hope of every Christian is rooted in God and in Christ, and they can never fail. His word is true. His promises are sure. His salvation is eternal. Our sin, we know, is an offense to God. He could have cast us off forever, but in mercy, he sent his son Jesus into this world to become a human being just like us, to live as a sinless life unlike us, to give that sinless life as an atoning payment in place of us, so that we who are guilty might declare to be innocent, because we've been forgiven by the very one we offended. Abundant mercy indeed. This hope is the hope that brings about our new birth, our second birth, our being born again. By our first birth, we're born sinners. By our first birth, we cannot please God no matter how hard we try. So God allows us to be born again through faith in Jesus Christ. By our new birth, we become children of God, and even more, sons and daughters, joint heirs with Christ. By our new birth, we can please God, live for him, and worship him, and be like him, and live with him forever. And that deserves an amen. This hope is made sure by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. The end of verse 3 states, "Blessed be God, who has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." This is a sure and a certain hope, a hope that cannot fail, a hope that is firmly anchored in heaven in the person of Christ. We don't know if we'll live a long life or what will happen to us in life, but we can know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we are safe in Jesus and that he will never fail us, never forsake us, either in this life or throughout all of eternity. That, my friends, is hope. The second truth about hope that Peter reveals is a hope that gives us an inheritance. Verse 4 says, "He gives us to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. We know that an inheritance is something that we haven't earned, which we have received through the death of a loved one. Receiving the inheritance means that someone has had to die. But unlike a worldly inheritance of money that can be spent and cannot go with us into eternity, God's inheritance can't be spent. It's incorruptible, lasting forever. God's inheritance is guaranteed. In verse 4 and 5, we see that it is reserved in heaven for you who are kept through the power of God through faith, ready to be revealed in the last time. That inheritance is being kept for us, and we are being kept for our inheritance. How are we kept? Our doctrine says it's through continued obedient faith in Christ. Even that faith is a gift of God. We are being kept for salvation. We have been saved from the penalty of our sin. We are being saved from the power of our sin. And we will one day be saved from the presence of our sin. Peter also reveals a hope that will keep us going through every trial. This life was not designed to be easy or free from difficulty or sorrow or suffering. Too many people base their whole lives on a false philosophy that says life should be easy. Do this, do that, use this, buy this. It's all making life simple. Even Christians get seduced by a false philosophy at times and wonder why they have to go through difficulties. As Christians, we too have struggles. There are no exemptions just because you're a Christian. Life is not easy, but hope will keep you going. Verse 6 says, "In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you've been grieved by various trials." But verse 7 then says, "That the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than that of gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found unto praise and honor and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ." God is only refined, gold is only refined by fire, sorry. Only in the fire can the junk be brought to the surface and skimmed off. God is in the process of refining us through the trials that we face. All those trials which seem so hard to bear are allowed by God as part of his refining process, and it will get us ready for glory. For in heaven there can be no impurity whatsoever. It's a prepared place for a prepared people. In the midst of our disappointments, we can take comfort in this. God is getting me ready for glory, and it'll make the trials easier to bear. Finally, this morning, Peter reveals a hope that is centered in the person of Jesus. We haven't seen Jesus with our physical eyes, but only with the eye of faith. We shall see Jesus, but that day is not yet. But having not seen him, we still love him. Question says, what does it mean to be a Christian? Well, it simply means this. It means to love Jesus, to love God with all our heart, our mind, our soul, and our strength, and love him in spite of the fact we haven't ever seen him. Deep inside the Christian heart is a joy that cannot be stopped or contained. It's a joy that's not natural, a joy that's not emotional. It's a joy that's rooted in our relationship with God. And nothing that happens to us can destroy that which God has placed in our soul. It's true. A Christian ought to be one of the most joyous people on the planet. The joy should show through our eyes. It should show through our face, through our expressions, through our body language, through everything about us. Everything about us should speak to others about the joy we have of our relationship with God who has saved us through his death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. If that's not joyful, what is? God loves us with an everlasting love. That ought to put a smile on your face too. Take joy in the hope that we have when our lives are grounded and rooted in Christ. A hope that transforms us when we accept Christ as Savior. A hope that gives us an inheritance in Christ. A hope that will see us through every trial that we face. And a hope that is only found in Jesus. Maybe this morning you don't feel you have hope. Maybe life's got you down. Maybe this pandemic and all the things that have gone with it have made you feel a little bit, life's heavy, life's difficult. Jesus stands ready to give you hope that is eternal and joy that not necessarily means you're going to be beaming around the place and yay, a joy that's in here, in the very heart and soul of our being. A joy that knows I'm safe no matter what. All you have to do is simply put your faith and your trust in him. Maybe you're just facing a trial and it seems impossible. My friends, there is hope. Trust in the sovereignty of God. Know that he is there in the midst of your circumstance. Know that God is in control. Someone asked us once when I was in Bible college to write down my life's philosophy. Well, they asked the class. Some people came back with some huge statements, some long 10, 12 words that would describe their life philosophy. I came back and said this: God is in control. Four words. Four words that I've lived by since then. I know that no matter what happens, my God is good. My God is in control, and in him is all the hope and the joy that I'll ever need. May God give you that hope and joy this morning. Let us pray. Father, thank you that you give a joy that passes our human understanding. You give us hope in the midst of difficulties. You are our hope, our firm foundation. May this morning each of us be enthused and infilled with your joy. In Christ's name, amen. As we close the service, I've asked that we join together and sing a familiar song, "Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning." The second verse says, "Give me joy in my heart, I pray." May that be our prayer today. God bless you all.